A very warm welcome to each and every one of you on this fourth Sunday in Advent. A welcome to our Zoomers who are joining us online, and a particular welcome to our baptismal party who are here for the baptism of Zach Theo Baxendale. What a lovely name to have. And a welcome to other visitors. It's great to have Scott and Becky with us, and anybody else who is joining us, because it's getting closer to the Christmas period and to holidays. It's lovely to have you all with us. Just a reminder that when we come to the baptismal service, after the baptism, the baptismal party will walk around the church so that you can all see young Zach, and then after that we sing May the Lord Mighty God, and you'll find that both of these are on the back of your order of service sheets, and remind you of those things. We have, which everyone is warmly invited. For that service this year, we're going to be making lantern. Apart from the COVID year's interval, we've been doing Christingles, but this year we're going to be making lanterns. But we do encourage you, as we always do, to bring your torches, anything that will help to light up the church. So if you've got a torch or a lantern or a lightsaber, we'll be glad to see that. Next Sunday, the 25th, is a Sunday. And because of that, we're going to have joint services in the town. So this year, we're going to Linktown Parish Church on the 25th, and then a similar arrangement for New Year's. So on the 1st of January, there will be a joint service at Abbots Hall Church, both at 11 a.m. These are all the church notices. I'm now going to ask Cathy Glachen to come forward, and she's going to read the preamble and light the Advent candles.
Are we on? Yeah. Oh, it's me. I'll have to go on tiptoe, sorry. The fourth Sunday of Advent, love. On this, we focus our minds on love, the love shown to us when God sent his Son. We did not earn this love. Instead, God gave it freely. We know that God's love was a costly thing. It would cost Jesus his life. Today, we remember the baby born in Bethlehem was the saviour of our world and the most precious gift that God could give. Through him, we have the promise of eternal life. In this season of Advent, we are called to respond to God's love by honouring Jesus and giving him the worship he deserves. We light these candles to remind ourselves that God's love never dies. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness does. Let us pray. God, we pray that the light of Christ will shine in our world today. May the love we show to others reflect the love of Jesus, so that everyone will know that we belong to him. Amen. We'll now sing from Mission Praise 503, O Little Town of Bethlehem.
It was the prophet Isaiah who said, "The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. They lived in a land of shadows, but now light shines upon them." Let's come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Come, Christ Jesus, be a guest in our hearts and our homes this Christmas. Enter our lives today with your blessing. We are grateful for the wonder you bring into a world so full of complaint and criticism. Draw near to us in friendship and faithfulness, so that in this season of celebration, we may know your presence and can sing with all your people. Come, Christ Jesus, be our guide through the darkening days and the chill of winter. Show us the way of wisdom and gratitude. We are thankful for the kindness we know in friends and good neighbors, in warm houses and warm smiles. Encourage us to reach out to those who need your embrace and ours, so that together we may proclaim the good news of your birth among us. Come, Christ Jesus, be our hope in this uncertain time. Touch us with your healing and grace. Lord of love, we confess we sometimes find your love daunting. You call us to love our neighbor, but we resist your call if our neighbors annoy us. You call us to love our enemies too, but that seems impossible in these contentious times. Forgive us for loving only in the safest situations. Dare us to love as Jesus loved, so that he will be born again in us. All these things we ask as together we share the prayer which you taught to your disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We now sing our next carol, which is quite appropriate for this time of year, Mission Praise 337, In the Bleak Midwinter.
As the tide has
Can I ask that the baptismal party now please come forward? Mark and Lauren, it's great to have Theo with us here today, along with his older brother, Caleb. Caleb, it wasn't that long ago that I baptized you, but as I was saying to you earlier, you're a little bit bigger now, and it's nice to see you here with your younger brother. It's a very special occasion for your family, and it's a very special occasion for the family of the church. And you're going to hear lots of big words used explaining baptism, but baptism is simply God's very special welcome of young babies and infants and sometimes older people into the family of the church. And we do that in a very special way as we use water, which symbolizes something special that's going on that God is doing with his Holy Spirit. So here are those special words. Jesus said, "Full authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore to all nations and make them my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teach them to observe all that I have commanded you, for I will be with you always to the end of time." In Luke's Gospel, we read, "Jesus called for the children and said, 'Let the children come to me. Do not try to stop them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, whoever does not accept the kingdom of God like a child will never enter it.'" Christ is present with us in the baptism. It is he himself who baptizes us, and by the Spirit of Pentecost, he brings us into his church. Baptism is the sign of dying to sin and rising to a new life in Christ. By water and the Holy Spirit, God claims us as his own, washes us free from sin, and sets us free from the power of death. In this sacrament, we are made one with Christ, crucified and risen. We become members of his body, called to share in his ministry in the world. In baptism, Zach is assured of the love that God has for him, and the sign and seal of the Holy Spirit is placed upon him. Mark and Lauren, in presenting Zach for baptism, desiring that he may be grafted into Christ as a member of his body, the church, do you pledge yourselves to glorify God and to follow the way of Christ in the power of his Holy Spirit? Do you believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord? Do you promise, depending on the grace of God, to teach your child the truths and duties of the Christian faith, and by prayer and example, to bring him up in the life and worship of the church? The Lord bless you and Zach, and enable you to faithfully keep these promises. Everyone who is gathered in church here today represents not just the family, but also the family of the church. As followers of Jesus, you have a responsibility to welcome other people in Christ's name. So will you be faithful to your calling as members of the Church of Christ, so that Zach and all other children in your midst may grow up in the knowledge and love of God. In acceptance of this responsibility, will you all please stand. Let us pray. We thank you, gracious God, for your gifts of water and the Holy Spirit. In the beginning, you moved over the waters of the earth and brought light and life to our world. At the appointed time, when Jesus was baptized by John in the River Jordan, you sent your Holy Spirit upon him. And now, by the baptism of his death and resurrection, Christ sets us free from sin and death and opens the way to eternal life. Send your Holy Spirit to be present with us now, that Zach, buried with Christ in baptism, may rise with him to newness of life, and being born anew of water and the Holy Spirit, may remain forever in the number of your faithful children, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Zach, for you, Jesus came into the world, and for you, he showed God's love. For you, he died on the cross and triumphed over death. He rose again in newness of life. For you, he ascended to reign at God's right hand. All this he did for you, but you do not know it yet. And so the word of Scripture is fulfilled. We love because God first loved us. Zach, Theo, Baxendale, I baptize you with this cold water in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord bless you and keep you both now and forevermore. Amen. We're now going to sing about that as we sing, first of all, the Lord bless you and keep you. And then we're going to sing, may the Lord, mighty God, bless you and keep you forever. Well done. Okay. According to Christ's commandment, Zach Theo Baxendale is now received into the membership of the one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church and is engaged to confess the faith of Christ crucified and to be his faithful soldier and servant unto his life's end. Lauren and Mark, children are a special gift from God, and you have been blessed by Zach's birth. From this day, he will be at home in the Christian community, and there will always be a place of welcome for him. Tell him of his baptism and unfold to him the treasure which he has been given today, so that he may know that he is baptized, and as he grows, make his own response in faith and love. And then come in due time to share round the Lord's table, celebrating the communion of his body and blood. The congregation may now be seated. Let us pray. Almighty God, we praise you for all that you have done for us. And just as no one can fully understand the immensity of your love, we thank you for welcoming Zach through the water of baptism in the early months of his life. As you have loved him from the beginning, may your Holy Spirit continue to bless him until he is of an age to make his own declaration of faith. Nurtured within the life of your church, may he become a loyal disciple of Jesus Christ. Today we thank you for your goodness to Lauren and Mark. Grant your blessing upon their home and help them to raise Zach in Christian love and joy. As we have witnessed this baptism today, may we treasure the gift of our own baptism and continue to walk in the light of Christ, blessed by the indwelling of your Holy Spirit, from this day forward and forevermore. Amen. Mark and Lauren, it's a great joy to have the baptism today, so close to Christmas Day. And as a token of our joy, I'm going to ask Cara to come forward, and she's going to present these flowers and a little gift to you from the congregation. Baptism for me is always very, very special, in part because we don't get enough baptisms these days. We would like to see far, far more. But it's always a great joy and a privilege when parents bring their child forward for baptism to become part of the church. And as I was saying in the script today, it's important that when children are baptized, as they grow up, they learn that that has been done for them and that this is something very, very special. And I know that we will take that responsibility very seriously, and I know how important faith is in the life of your family, and that is why you are here today. But today, for us, it's a great day of joy, a great day of celebration. And I know, Zach, although it was cold morning, I didn't mean it to be very cold. It's just that it's quite chilly outside. And believe it or not, water was quite warm earlier. We talked up and looked a bit warm. But baptism is a special thing. And it reminds us that we are part of God's family, and there is always a place of welcome for us. And we know that in Christ's family, we are never, ever alone. We can always talk to God in prayer in a very, very special way. So our prayer, and the prayer of all the congregation, the prayer of your family and friends, is that you and Zach will be blessed, not just today, but all through your family life together. Now I'm going to sing about another family, the Holy Family, as we sing Mission Praise, number 47, Away in a Manger.
Amen.
Please be seated. I'd like to ask Kate Walker to come forward, and she's going to read our Old and New Testament scripture lessons.
Our first reading this morning is from the New Testament, from the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 7, verses 10 to 16. The sign of Emmanuel. The Lord sent another message to Ahaz. Ask the Lord your God to give you a sign. It can be from deep in the world of the dead, or from high up in the heaven. Ahaz answered, I will not ask for a sign. I refuse to put the Lord to the test. To that Isaiah replied, Listen now, descendants of King David. It's bad enough for you to wear out the patience of people. Do you have to wear out God's patience too? Well then, the Lord himself will give you a sign. A young woman who is pregnant will have a son and will name him Emmanuel. By the time he's old enough to make his own decisions, people will be drinking milk and eating honey. Even before that time comes, the land of those two kings who terrify you will be deserted. Our New Testament reading is from Matthew. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. The birth of Jesus. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ took place. His mother Mary was engaged to Joseph, but before they were married, she found out that she was going to have a baby by the Holy Spirit. Joseph was a man who always did what was right. But he did not want to disgrace Mary publicly, so he made plans to break the engagement privately. While he was thinking about this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, descendant of David, do not be afraid to take Mary to be your wife, for it is by the Holy Spirit that she has conceived. She will have a son, and you will name him Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins. Now all this happened in order to make come true what the Lord had said to the prophet. A virgin will become pregnant, and he will be called Emmanuel, which means God is with us. So when Joseph woke up, he married Mary, as the angel of the Lord had told him to. But he did not have marital relations with her before she gave her first son, and Joseph named him Jesus. Amen, and may God add his blessings to these readings from his holy word. Our next item of worship is Mission Praise 589, See Him Lying on a Bed of Straw.
Thank you.
Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Last week we were looking at the prophet Micah, someone whose role in the Christmas story is often overlooked. And this morning I want to focus on the figure of Joseph, another individual who is largely overlooked, and yet someone who is an unsung hero. In the Christmas nativities, Joseph is numbered among the supporting cast, someone who makes a walk-on appearance, who never actually speaks, someone who's not even Jesus' biological father. So we dismiss him as a mere bit player in the greatest story ever told. But nothing could be further from the truth. Without Joseph's goodness, faithfulness, and trust, God would have had to find another way to save his people from their sins. Without Joseph, even the ancient prophecies would have been wrong. So what does the Bible actually tell us about Joseph? Firstly, we know that he could trace his roots back to King David and beyond. The Gospels of Matthew and Luke both contain genealogies of Jesus, and the one in Matthew is traced back to King David through Joseph. So Joseph is of long-standing Jewish heritage. But just because he can trace his family tree back to royalty does not mean that he is wealthy or aristocratic. In actual fact, he's far from it. It's often assumed that Joseph was a carpenter by trade and that he passed on his trade to Jesus. But the word used to describe Joseph's occupation in Greek was actually tekton, which means artisan or builder. An artisan or builder could certainly work in wood, but interestingly could also be described as a stonemason. And let's not forget that some of Jesus' parables include mention of cornerstones or capstones or building houses on a rock. Either way, Joseph was a skilled manual worker from solid Jewish stock. To these basic facts, church tradition tells us that Joseph was quite a bit older than Mary. And when he's depicted in church art, he's often shown to be that way. Joseph is usually shown as a mature man, where Mary is always thought to have been not much older than a teenager. One reason that Joseph is thought to have been much older than Mary is because he's not mentioned in the Gospels after the time Jesus is 12. And Joseph and Mary find him in the temple teaching the scribes. Joseph does not feature again in any of the Gospels. So it's assumed that he died before Jesus started his ministry. Although we have little in the way of factual information about Joseph, today's Gospel reading actually tells us a great deal about his character, which is equally important. At the start of our reading, it says that Jesus' mother Mary was engaged or betrothed to be married to Joseph. But before they were married, she found out that she was going to have a baby by the Holy Spirit. In Jewish culture and in those days, marriage was a two-stage process that started with betrothal, something which was broadly similar to engagement. However, when a Jewish couple were betrothed, they would probably take a vow of celibacy that would be respected until the day of their marriage. So when Joseph and Mary were engaged, there was a very clear expectation of celibacy. And then, of course, Mary must have spoken to Joseph and dropped a bombshell into his life. "Joseph, there's something I have to tell you, and you might find it a little hard to believe. You see, I'm pregnant, and the baby comes from God." There's something almost comical in this situation, and yet it's deadly serious. It seems comical to us because for all of us, this seems totally unbelievable. The only thing preventing us from dismissing this entirely out of hand is the fact that our Christian faith tells us that nothing is impossible for God. Needless to say, I think we can imagine that this must have been a very difficult conversation between Mary and Joseph. It's clear from the story that at first Joseph didn't believe Mary's story, and who could have blamed him? Naturally, he decided to break off the engagement, which he did privately. Had he wanted, Joseph could have made life very hard for Mary. In his eyes, she had committed adultery, and under the Mosaic law, the penalty for adultery was death. Joseph could certainly have turned Mary over to the court, and she could have been stoned to death. But we are told that Joseph was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace. So he decided that the best thing to do was to break the engagement off quietly. But then God intervenes, but not in the way we might expect. God speaks to Joseph in a dream, not unlike another righteous Joseph many centuries before. In Joseph's dream, an angel reveals that Mary's child is indeed from God, and Joseph should not be afraid to take Mary as his wife, and that the child has been sent to deliver the world from its sins in fulfillment of the ancient prophecies about the Messiah. The important thing here is that when Joseph woke up, he had a very clear choice. He could have done what most of us do every day. He could have dismissed his dream as nothing more than a dream, brought on by Mary's story and the stress of the situation. But Joseph took the much harder option of trusting that God had really spoken to him, of accepting God's plan and purpose for the world, and saying yes to playing his part in God's story, even if that meant sharing in Mary's public disgrace. Joseph was a righteous man, not self-righteous. He didn't try to draw attention to himself in any way. Instead, he accepted the wondrous and mysterious ways of God in using Mary as part of his plan of salvation. And being godly and righteous, Joseph would have known the prophecies, especially those of the prophet Isaiah, from an early age. We read one of those prophecies this morning, which spoke of a young woman who would give birth to a son. That son would be named Emmanuel, which means God is with us. So Joseph heard and believed Mary's story, and he decided to trust God and to trust Mary. We know Mary was the one who gave birth to this to our son, but it was Joseph who obeyed the command of the angel to have the baby named Jesus. And when we think about how God spoke to Joseph through dreams, perhaps we should recognize those times when God communicates with us in ways that we might not expect. Of course, God's principal form of guidance today is the Word of God contained in Scripture and the guidance of the Holy Spirit. But within the pages of the Bible, there are plenty of examples of God's use of dreams. Dreams aren't just for the visionaries in the pages of the Bible. They are for people like you and me. Dreams help us to make sense of who we are and our place in life. We might have dreams about our progress in life and where our priorities truly are. Dreams about our society and how it can become a better place when people work together. Dreams about our nation and what its core values truly should be. Dreams about our church and what God might want it to be. Dreams which say to us, with Christ, all things are possible, and nothing and no one is beyond his reach. Remember that when God spoke to Joseph through his dreams, his life was never the same again. So as we consider the Christmas story, may our perspective and our priorities be changed as well. Amen. Let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you for the privilege of meeting in worship, for the opportunity to share our Christian faith, for the joy of welcoming a new life into the church, and for the chance to hear your word in the season of Advent. As we offer our thanks, make us mindful of the needs of others so that we might reach out in prayerful concern. Come, Lord Jesus, to those who are suffering severe financial hardship. Help us to bring food to the hungry, warmth to the cold, and reassurance to the anxious. We pray for all charities and agencies working to give advice, support, and a listening ear to those in need. Come, Lord Jesus, to those torn apart by war and civil conflict. Help us to work for peace in the small ways that present themselves to us. We pray for the people of Ukraine, Russia, Somalia, Syria, and all other people who are oppressed in their own countries. Come, Lord Jesus, to those suffering the effects of climate change and natural disasters. Help us to be generous in our response. Come, Lord Jesus, to those whose work is to protect and restore our environment. Encourage them in their difficult work in the face of huge challenges. Help us hear their message and be willing to respond in ways that we can. We remember at this time the people of Pakistan and Indonesia, the island nations of the Pacific, and all people struggling to rebuild their lives. Come, Lord Jesus, to those for whom Christmas is not a time of family laughter and reunion. We bring before you in prayer the people of Jersey following the gas explosion and the loss of so many lives. And we bring before you the community in Solihull, West Midlands, who mourn the loss of children drowned in an icy pond. Lord Jesus, friend of the helpless, help us to reach out to all those in situations of sadness and sorrow. As we approach the joyful season of Christmas, we continue to pray for those who are lonely, those who feel unloved, those who are homeless, those in family conflict, those in prison, and refugees far from home. We pray for those who are bereaved and for whom Christmas is a time of loss. Help us to care, to listen, and to comfort. Lord Jesus, draw near to us all in this Advent season. Grant the peace of your presence, the healing of your touch, the blessing of your guidance, and the assurance of your constant love. This day and always. Amen. We now conclude our service as we sing together the carol, Mission Praise 588, See Amid the Winter's Snow. May the peace of God, which passes all human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with you and those whom you love, this day and forevermore.